caffeine. Would you do this with me? Because we're a little bit jacked up today. Let's just give a huge round of applause to everyone on the other side of the camera with us online. YouTube, Apple, Spotify, Bergman Campus, Calico Rock. What's going on? So grateful that you're here. We're in our last week, and I'm actually having a little bit of fear of missing out on this series because I hate shutting it down, but it's such a powerful, powerful series. I encourage you, especially for many of you who I visited with for the first time today, and this is your first time here, you can go back online, watch these messages. But as we conclude this series, we don't want to conclude our rebuilding. We don't want to conclude our reconstructing. We don't want to conclude doing everything we can to protect our personal lives, our marriages, our home, our future, our business, our whatever it is, our health, whatever God is calling you to. We need to continue to rebuild and reconstruct. And once we get to the place where this area or that area, whatever it is God's saying to you, is built, there's always going to be something else. But there's also evidence when you are building and you're at the place, which we're going to be looking at in Nehemiah chapter 8, all the way over to chapter 10, 13 chapters in Nehemiah. I encourage you to read them all. We're going to conclude here in 10, though. But as you see it, the wall's built. Everything's done. Gates are set. Watchtower's up. Just as a reminder, especially those of you who may be with us for the first time, we're at 3 foot deep. We're at 16 foot wide. Above the 3 feet, there's 40 foot of wall, 4.5 miles long. There's a bunch of arrow sits. There's a bunch of moats. There's 32 watchtowers, something I love, and you can go there to this day and walk through one of the 8 gates. I love the word 8 in the Bible. It's an indicator of new beginnings. It indicates the word brand new. If you ever show up and we just got a big 8 on the building, it still means the same thing. It means brand new. Matter of fact, 8th day was circumcision when they recognize a new life. There's 8 beatitudes. We see Jesus speaks to the disciples after the resurrection 8 times. We walk through the scripture. You can see so many beautiful pictures of 8. When you look at the watches or the times, there is 24 hours, but there's 3 8 watches. Every watch is a brand new moment in your life in a 24-hour period. That's how God designed it. It's not on accident at all. I love it. And we see that with the 8 gates right here in the wall as well. Just so you know, this wall is a big deal, and it's a big deal to this day. It's a big deal to this day. Matter of fact, many of you have seen people praying at a portion of this wall. Some people call it the Wailing Wall. It's actually the wall of the Holy of Holies. The reason that you see people doing the Wailing Wall moment or putting paper in prayer is because that's the lower level of the wall where the Holy of Holies would have sat, where the presence of God actually sat when the temple resided there and the presence of God resided there, even up till Jesus' time. And that's why you see people with that extra sense of urgency at that moment, at that section of the wall. But you see that wall was built by the Canaanites, and then it busted up a little bit, and then the Jebusites come in, build it up a little bit, and then the next thing you see, David, his mighty man, great story. Matter of fact, you can crawl in the caves that they built that took them all the way up to conquer. You can crawl in those to this day. It's so powerful. And then we see Solomon did a little bit of work there. Hezekiah did a little bit of work after that. And then we're right here at the moment where Nehemiah rebuilds the wall. The Babylonian Empire toasted it. The Persian Empire toasted it. And it was in rubble. 52 days later, through obedience to God and a supernatural act with God's power, they built the wall back. Such a beautiful picture. And what God's telling you and I is this. I don't know what's collapsed. I don't know where you feel there's a lack of success. I don't know what it is in your life where you, man, I need to build this back. I know this. God wants to reconstruct it. God wants you to rebuild it. God wants you to experience success, passion, purpose. He wants you to experience protection. That's what this wall is a picture of. It's a picture not only the protection of God, but the presence and the power of God. And once that wall was built, you can see in Nehemiah chapter 8 here, all the way through chapter 10, even in 11, 12, 13, which gives more of the history of the governance and so forth and so on there, reminder of the law to the conclusion of where we see Nehemiah walking out of the leadership there in 13, but continuing influence. We see the beauty of what it looks like in your life and mine when we are in the middle of, or we're at the conclusion of even, rebuilding something. There's four things that is shown right here in the text. If you've said, I'm building a greater marriage, I'm building purity in my life, I'm building a greater financial understanding of God's promises, I'm walking in building greater health in my life because I recognize my body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, I'm building something better in my parenting, I'm building something better for my future, I'm building something, I'm not just going to college, I'm building a vision and a focus in my vocation that I'm going to make a difference for the cause of Christ. There's four things that will be evident in your life and my life when you surrender to this moment, when you say yes to building this. The first is this: you're going to be serious about passage pursuit. And what do I mean by that? You're going to be serious about studying the Word of God. You're going to be serious about knowing the Word of God, because when you're about God, doing God's work, you don't want to kind of sort of wonder whether or not I'm doing the right thing and I'm in the middle of the right thing. That's exactly what transpired. They get the gates set, the walls there, they bring the people in, all of those that were in captivity at one time, they come in, and then it says that they set up a moment, even use the word at one time in a couple of portions of the scripture here, a festival, and here's what they did. They read the Bible. And they didn't just read it. Look at verse number 8 of Nehemiah chapter 8. It says they read from the book of the law. Again, you got to realize they didn't have a copy of the Bible. They didn't have the Bible app. They didn't have BibleGateway.com or whatever you use, YouVersion. They didn't have that. They didn't have a copy. Matter of fact, they could only hear it yearly. They knew most of it just by word of mouth. They didn't know, and at least everyone here hasn't even been able to go to church because the place has been destroyed. And so they're hearing most of this just in verbatim and for memorization, but they're here. The Levites are there, the priests are there, and the Bible says this. It says that they read from the book of the law, and I want you to catch this here. And it says this, and they clearly explain what it meant. There was clear explanation. And I just want to encourage everyone that's at the sound of my voice is to make sure that you are serious, not just about reading God's word, but getting clear understanding. To get the clearest understanding, you need to be saved. The Spirit of God gives you the reflection, the understanding of what the Bible says. The Spirit of God allows you to understand it at a greater level. And it says that they clearly explain the meaning. Of course, Ezra's throwing down right now. You know, he's giving all this explanation here. You can read the book of Ezra and learn a little bit more in the history sense. But he's giving clear explanation, the meaning. Look at this. The meaning of what was being read. And then this is another key part, helping people understand each passage. And what I want to just say, whatever you're building in your life, whatever you're reconstructing in your life, whatever God has got you in, whether it's a parenting vision, a business vision, a marriage vision, for me personally right now, it's right here in the middle of the vocation that God's called, because we're literally in the middle of building. We just finished building the student room in our Bergman campus, adding 5,000 square feet to that place. It's just unbelievable. We're in the middle of building in Farmington, in case you didn't know. We're in the process of that. So for me, I'm experiencing a lot of understanding just personally how to build a church when you're exponentially growing, where you're literally growing hundreds a month. And since Mother's Day, literally doubling the church, doubling the kids area. And I'm so grateful to God for that, and there's rebuild, reconstructing, but I know there's indicators that we're doing the right thing, and the first is you're passionate about the Word of God, and you're pursuing clear understanding. It's not kind of, sort of. What I want to challenge you in your personal journey with God as you are desiring that is to desire insight over input. Now, I want to explain this a little bit. They weren't just reading the law. They were going through it and understanding it and making sure that everyone understood it. And I have friends, I have people that all the time are like, man, I'm in the middle of this Bible study and I'm reading through the Bible in a year. I say that's fantastic. Matter of fact, you can even pat yourself on the back. I think it's great to read through the Bible in a year. But if you don't understand, if it's just input, not insight, I challenge you not to do that. Now, you can do that on the side. If you just want an accomplishment, then that's what happens. We oftentimes will operate in checklists versus understanding what the check of the Holy Spirit is when we're reading the Word of God. And my challenge to you is this: the Word of God is still sharp. The Word of God is still alive. You read it and don't necessarily understand all of it. It's still cutting you. It's the Word of God. But as a Christ follower, if you're digging and you're building and you're going at it, especially if you're supposed to stab something, you need to know what you're supposed to stab. You need to know what you're not supposed to stab. You need to know what you're going to be. You need insight over input. This morning, personally, in my personal worship in Proverbs chapter 10, verse 6, just I read the entirety of the chapter, but I stopped on 6. And the Bible says this in Proverbs 10, 6, in my personal worship time. It said this. It says, the godly is showered with his blessing. And I'm like, I'm going to walk with Jesus and get some Jesus blessings. How many of you want a shower of the blessings of God Almighty? Listen, I didn't need anything else. Then it goes on and it talks about how you receive those blessings. And it's simply in obedience to Christ. Now, ultimately, we know we're covered, we're blessed because of the shed blood of Jesus, but there is extra out there. There's more filling to be had. There's more blessing to be had. I want all of it. I want all I can possibly receive. And so that's where I stopped. I could have went on and maybe dug in a little more. I could have read, some Psalms. I could have memorized the book of Nahum if I wanted to after that, but I didn't. I got insight. You need to seek insight as well. Insight takes time. Input is just something you heard. Nothing wrong with reading a lot of scripture at one time. Please do not misunderstand what I'm saying. But what I know is this, there's a ton of people that will try for input instead of insight. Do what Nehemiah said. If I'm building something, I want to know where I'm supposed to go, and I want to know what I'm supposed to know. Just dive into it. And if God stops you after one verse, if God's Spirit, the Holy Spirit stops you after two verses, stop. Jot some things down. Note take. Say, man, I want the presence of God. I want the power of God. I want the shower blessings of God in my life. And it takes time to desire that insight. I love what the Scripture goes on and says they came back the second day, did the exact same thing. Matter of fact, look at Nehemiah 8 and verse 13. It says on October 9, I don't know if you ever stop and do this, but you hear me do it almost every week. And that is this: October 9 just gets me jacked up. Does it anybody else? I just love how beautiful the Word of God is. It says on October 9, in case you didn't know, I just want you to know that it was October 9. The beauty of that is this. If you go all the way back to the understanding of the timeline of this, here's why it's so powerful. Because all of it lines up perfectly and there's no error. You can go all the way back to the beginning, all the way to the 52 days when they're finished at the end of chapter 6, all the way up to 8, all the way up to the multi-years of his leadership and governance. And it's all perfectly dated. I love that. It says that the family leaders of all the people on October 9th, together with the priests and the Levites, met with Ezra the scribe to go over all of the law. And here it is again. This is day 2. In greater detail. So if you're building, you want to go into this and you want to be able to answer things. You want to know what's going on and you want to be able to help people with it. As a pastor, I want to know as much as I can. I don't know everything about the Bible, not even close. I forget things regularly and get more inspired, but I want to be ready to answer any questions I can because I have parents that need assistance. I got church members that need assistance. I got family members that need assistance. I had a parent DM me this last week and said, hey, can you help me? My family member sent me a TikTok, which I can barely tolerate TikTok doctrine and theology, but people are getting a lot of it. At least we're asking questions. That's Shannon's positive side. And they're like, well, they believe, according to this TikTok, that Hare Krishna and the Krishna doctrine lines up with Christianity. And I was like, oh, Jesus, help me, Lord. And I had so much fun just ripping that TikTok a new one. And not only that, the parent was appreciative too. And you're like, Shannon, that sounded arrogant. Well, here's the thing. It's not arrogance, but it is this. You need to be ready to give an answer. And no one's questioning more than this generation that's here now. This generation now, they are smart, they're sharp, and they're seeking the Holy Ghost. And we better be ready because the next thing you know, if not, they're going to think Hare Krishna and Jesus were brothers or something crazy like that. Oh, wait, that's the Mormons. Either way, I'm just saying, you need to know why you believe what you believe. The second thing is this. When you're reconstructing, not only you have passage pursuit, you're going to be praising God. When you build something, don't you praise? Don't you? Speaking of TikTok, speaking of Instagram, I mean, those of you that are building, I see it on there. You show pictures. It's like, oh, we just put in the new room. We just got the driveway in. We just built our gun safe in this hidden closet, which is God's will for every home. And maybe even in the pastor's office of the new building. Either way, I'm just saying. That's probably illegal. I just know that you put it on there and you're celebrating and you're praising the success and the beauty of this whatever you're building, right? We should do the same thing when our marriage gets healthy, when our kids get healthy, when our finances get healthy, when our health gets healthy, then you're going to be praising. Look what the Word of God says. This is exactly what happened. Nehemiah chapter 8, verse number 6. It says this, Ezra the preacher praised the Lord. He praised God. He praised the Lord, and it says, the great God and all the people, here we go, getting charismatic. This is a Pentecostal church here back here in the day. Look at it. It says they all lifted their hands. Now, I'm not going to make anybody lift their hands, but just try it for a minute. Just kind of lift your hands up a little bit. I know it's a little warm in here for some. Now, what's crazy is many people won't do that in worship, but you'll do it at a Razorback game. That always weirds me out. I just don't feel comfortable lifting my hands in public. Woo, pig suey! Just don't feel comfortable. And Brandon Church, we even turned the lights out to help you if you got a sweat pit. I mean, it's like it's dark. I mean, raise your hand, bless the Lord. And you're like, well, I don't feel like lifting my hands. We don't lift our hands for us. We lift it for him, say, surrender. We're surrendering to you. This is not my agenda. And not only that, it just says they didn't just lift their hands. Look what else they did. They responded. Oh, hallelujah. You're like, Shannon, you're getting charismatic. You're crazy. I'm just reading the Bible. I know this. When I praise things, it don't matter if it's a good meal or how delicious my wife looks, I'm going to yell something out in Jesus' name. Amen? Yes. Right? We need to respond, and here's his response. I love that. I love the Bible. You love it? He responded, amen and amen. Whee! Hallelujah. I got to play the organ. Somebody get me an organ sound in Jesus' name. Jamie, hook that up. I need an organ sound for the next service. Whee! Amen and amen responded. You know what I'm saying? What God building something in your life, you're praising him for it. You can't wait to tell somebody. You can't wait to celebrate it. It is a natural response. Then the people, not only they lift their hands, not only they shout amen and amen, it says they bowed down and worshiped. There's moments where you recognize he ain't your bro. He ain't your bubs. He ain't the good man upstairs. He's this. He's holy God, almighty God, majestic God, creator of the universe, God. He ain't your bubs. He ain't your friend. Is he the friend of sinners? No doubt about it. But we got to sometimes just bow down and go, you're God, I'm not. I'm surrendering to you, Jesus. And they bowed down and they worshiped. That means worth-ship. It means I get on the boat and I float in the worthiness of God and him only. That's what worth-ship means. I'm recognizing the worth of God. I'm rowing in the worth of who he is and only. That's what the word worship means. And for you and I, he says they worship with their faces to the ground. And then in verse number 10, it says this. You know this verse. You got it memorized. The joy of the Lord is my strength. Hallelujah. The joy. Christians ought to be the happiest people on planet Earth. They're none of this. Starchio, sassy, frass, average, weak, tofu, kale-eating, weak sauce, average. We ought to be happy as we are eating a 50-piece McNugget in Jesus' name with some hot mustard with a 4-year-old kid. Just eating it. Glory to God. I loved it. I took Alba to ice cream, and I just love watching her eat it because she did more than eat it. She wore it. I was like, yes, that's my girl. Train the child in the way they should go. Hallelujah. She just wearing ice cream. She just had it all over, and it's the cutest thing ever. She opened her mouth. So spiritually, we should be wearing it. We should be wearing the joy. We should be living happy. We should be excited. We should be energetic. If you're building something great, aren't you excited about it? And then with that praise, it leads to priorities. And you can see what their priorities were. They're listed here. I'm going to go through them extremely expedited. Their priorities were this. They built their homes temporarily close to the house of God. And you need to get your house close to the house of God. The house of God is priority according to the Word of God. Church is not an option. People say, I can worship at home. The Bible doesn't teach that. Everybody okay with the Bible? Raise your hand. I know I'm setting you. Here's the thing. You're like, well, I don't have to go to church to worship. You should go to church to worship because the Bible tells you to. And not only that, they didn't just go to church to worship. They built temporary houses next to the house of God just so they could be there in the moment of the revival they were experiencing. And sometimes you just need a tent close to the church. Now, I'm not recommending that to anyone, but I am saying that it was, for them, there was quite a bit of a travel here. And they didn't have, you know, Fords and Chevys and Hondas to get them there. And most of them didn't even have animals to get them there. But all the captives came, and they built tents there. You need your house close to God. So everyone who returned from captivity lived in shelters during the festival. And they were filled with great joy. They were close to the house. And you need to be close to the house. You need to be in proximity of the house. You need to make the house priority in your house. The house of God needs to be priority. Jesus built one thing. He said, I will build my church. He built the church. He instituted the church. The church is priority A. There is no priority B. There's no nonprofit. There's no parachurch. There's all those are good things. Don't misunderstand me. But he came to build the local church, the bride of Christ, until his return. And that is the message and avenue of the gospel. And we're a part of that. Let's share it. Let's praise. Let's prioritize it. Let's get close to the house. The second thing they did is they separated themselves. It says, and again, we're going on here, and you can read in chapter 9. All the individuals are listed there that sealed. We'll talk about that in just a second. This surrender, this yes to this building and this unbelievable monument to God they built through the wall. It says, but the rest of the people, the priests, the Levites, verse 28 of chapter 10 of Nehemiah, the gatekeepers, the singers, the temple servants. Can I just tell everybody, by the way, this is how we set up our church too. This is how we set our church up. The priests, the Levites, that's our staff. The gatekeepers, that's door greeters. The singers, you know who those people are. Temple servants, that's more volunteers. What'd they all do? They all separated themselves from pagans. Now, I'm not saying we don't love pagans. We don't invite pagans. But people will get you more sidetracked from a great building, a reconstruction, a better marriage than anything. And you need to make a separation of who I can hang with, who I can Friday night with, who I can spend time on DMs with. You need to make sure you're around people that inspire you and make you better, because there's a ton of people that are going to try to pull you from the wall. Don't get off. Stay focused on the mission. Number three is they followed the word of God. They didn't just separate themselves. They didn't just study God's word. They followed it. And verse 28 part B says, in order to obey the law of God together with, look at this, they're all in. Their wives, their sons, their daughters, and all who were old enough to understand. In other words, you need to be passionate about the word of God, and you need to get the right people in your life, and the people that are your people need to be passionate about the word of God. And you need, I love having conversations with my kids about the word of God. I love when anybody comes to me within our family and wants to have TikTok doctrine conversations about the word of God. I love when people come to, I love praying the word of God over my kids. I love communicating the word of God. I love having an answer that's the word of God concerning areas with my kids, my family, people that I love. And then they were so serious about it. In verse number 1 of that same chapter 10, it says that the document that they had where they're all like, we're in this, we're doing this, we're going to walk in this, we're going to prioritize this, we're going to praise God, we're going to live in this protection, we're going to obey God's word. It says that they ratified and sealed it with the names of the people that were there. In other words, you need to do the same thing with the people closest to you. You need to say, we're in this, we're going to ratify this, we're sealed. Nothing's going to take me off the wall. I'm going to stay focused on God's word. I'm going to prioritize my home. I'm going to praise Jesus. Matter of fact, would you sign on the dotted line right now that you're going to be in it to win it? And that's what you and I should do as well. And then the last thing is not just going to the house of God, but they understood that the house of God kept them focused on their priorities. If you go to chapter 10 and just jump down, if you take verses 32 through 39 of chapter 10, it says the church 9 times in those verses. It says house of God specifically, but speaking of the church. Nehemiah 10, 32 through 39. 9 different times it talks about God's house. God's house is a big deal. You're like, Shannon, you already said that. Well, I'm saying it again because Nehemiah did. And he says this, we will, look at verse 39 of Nehemiah chapter 10. And this is a great verse for your home. This is a great plaque, a t-shirt, something you put up. We will not neglect the house of God. We are not backing away from it. We're not shying down. We're not skipping. We're not saying kind of, sort of. It's priority to God. It's priority to me. We will not neglect it. And we're going to be serious about it. And we're going to get serious. They got serious about not only the house of God, but how it was built. As you know, they go on and they're trying to build to its greater glory. And even when we're in the midst of building the building, that we're doing right now. Oftentimes, I'm looking at places to cut costs and keep it as cheap as we can. And the one that's building it, I won't mention his name, but it rhymes with Jerry Coyle. He's always like, Shannon, I ain't building your house. I'm building God's house. I was like, oh, preach that. Hallelujah. Yes, Jesus. We're going to have the best opportunity. So kids walk in there and say, Jesus, I want to be a part of the church. And guess what? Then they're going to meet the Holy Spirit. Then they're going to meet Jesus crucified, resurrected Jesus. They're going to make him Lord of their life. Why? Because they fell in love with what we prioritize, the house of God. Amen. And you need to do the same thing. What never ceases to amaze me is this. All of us are about these things. We're all about praise, priorities. We're all about passage pursuit. I know you are. I know you're about those things. I want to keep this revival. I want to stay in this project, this reconstruction, this building in my life. But in 34 years of ministry, full-time ministry in June, it'll be 34 years. You know what never ceases to amaze me is this. There are people, they're Christians. And some genuinely Christians, they've developed a kind of selective vision, which basically allows an individual to deeply and maybe even sincerely involve themselves in worship and volunteering, faithful maybe attendance, participate in midweek church activities, maybe even go to a camp or a marriage event, but then get to work or school, and they live almost totally pagan lives where it's like nothing really even happened. Yeah. And I get it. I get it. I mean, I understand the trip up. But what I want to charge you with is this. Let's don't do that anymore. Let's build something great for God. Stay close to what God is asking us to build, and let the revival fire just fire us up. What do we do? We get these principles. We get them corporately, but what do we do for personal revival? How do we apply these things to our lives? How do we take these things? I want praise. I want greater praise. I want greater passage pursuit. I want to see the areas of my life prioritized, in my house, my kids, my family, the word. But how do I keep that or even ignite that revival fire in my life so that we can keep building, so I can stay on the wall, so I can grab this sword and be willing to fight off the enemy? I believe there's a few ways, three or four ways that you can do this, where you can stay focused on the rebuilding portion so that you can get to the place where you have the rebuilding and you're willing to fight for it, where you're willing to do whatever it takes to fight for it because you know what it's worth. But it has to start in you first. See, if Nehemiah hadn't had the personal revival, the community would never have experienced the public revival. So how do we experience personal revival? How do we experience personal revival fire? Point number one is this. You got to have a fire. You got to make sure there is a fire. If there's no fire, there's no fire. But if there is a fire, fire is consumed by more fire. Or the fact that somebody says, I'm going to choose something different. And I would say for many of us here, I'm not saying that you're not saved, but I know this. The Bible teaches that people that are saved have the Spirit's fire. And for you, it may be just buried under some ash and there's just embers there. And you just need a good wind of the Holy Spirit to bring back, and it's just a little bit of kindling from a friend and get that baby cranked up again. But for some of us, we've never been saved. We've never truly repented of our sins, where we truly said, I'm done going my way. I'm not talking about an emotion, walking it out, praying a prayer. I'm not even talking about getting dunked. I'm talking about I was headed this way. Now I'm turned and I'm going God's way. And then the Spirit of God's fire is seated in your heart. Let me show it to you in the scripture in 1 Corinthians 3:13. It says, their work will be shown for what it is because the day will bring it to light and it'll be revealed by fire. And the fire will test the quality of each person's work. The test of your life is shown by fire, and the test of your daily living is the fire. As a matter of fact, so much so that the scripture says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 that your actions of your life can put out the Spirit's fire. And when you're on fire for God, you're going to torch everything around you. I've said this many times. I'll never stop saying it. Once you've seen the fire, you're not satisfied with the smoke. I mean, you ain't taking the old smoke blowing in your face. When you felt the heat, you felt the power, you felt the anointing, you saw your family change, you saw addiction set free, you saw finances come in, you saw healing take place. Once you've seen the fire of God, you ain't satisfied with the smoke. And I'll just say this when it comes to church, and I'll say it in closing very quickly, and that is this. I don't want to be a part of a church that just smoke, though we got a bunch of smoke here. I'm just saying this. I want to be a part of a church that's on fire, where we're seeing things change. People want to be a part of it. People are excited about it. People want, and it ignites other people. There is nothing like a community, a church, a belonging body of Christ on fire for God that'll change the community. People want to be a part of it. People are asking about it. And I encourage you to make sure you have the Spirit's fire living in you, that you're 100% certain if you were to die right now that you're saved. Number two is this. You need to confess every known sin to God. If you want to keep this fire, if you want to move forward in it. And it's not just a confession upon salvation. Jesus Christ's shed blood pays for all sin, past, present, and future. All your sins are forgiven. If you believe that, say amen. Amen. It is. Now, in fellowship with God, we're keeping a short sin account. And when I make a mistake, I look at my wife and say, would you please forgive me? That guy flipped off. I go and park beside him at Walmart and say, hey, I shouldn't have done that. Would you please forgive me? I make an angry moment right with my kids by saying, please forgive me. Maybe I disobeyed God and I made a promise to him and I didn't do it. You say, as the Spirit convicts, would you please forgive me? That's what it's like to live in obedience, to keep that revival fire. We confess it. We confess with our mouth compromise. We confess with our mouth anything that's calloused in our life. We confess with our mouth things that we participated in with friends we shouldn't have. Would you please forgive me, Lord Jesus? And we daily do that. And here's what I challenge you to do as a Christ follower. Don't just say, please forgive me all my sins. Amen. That's cheap confession. I can't do that with my wife. You know all those things I did over the last month? Forgive me. That ain't going to work. We're going to walk through these things and make them better. It's the same way with your groom, Jesus. And not only that, you need to honor him. And Jesus says, I'm faithful and just to forgive you. And we want to keep that short sin account so we can be in right standing and have greater fellowship with God, more of his fire, more of his anointing, more of his power. And by the way, he's already paid for it. The third thing we've got to do, if you want to keep this personal fire, keep rebuilding, keep reconstructing. Not only do we need to make sure there is a fire, confess every known sin to God every day. The third thing we need to do is this. You need to put away doubtful habits. Now, I know you're going to be like, Shannon's meddling again. Here we go. Here he goes on his little rant. Here he goes on his stuff that I like, that he should like, or whatever it is. You know, the Bible teaches it this way in Hebrews chapter 12, one of my favorite chapters in all of Scripture. In verse number 1, he says, therefore we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses. Every time I hear that, I always think of my grandma. I mean, I think of my mom now, who's in that great cloud of witnesses, cheering us on. The apostles, Abraham, Moses. Why do we know that? Because the chapter before that gives a litany list of everybody that went before us and did great things for him. It says, therefore, if there's a therefore, wherefore, find out what it's there for. That's chapter 11. And it says, we're surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses because people are watching us and cheering us on. It says to do two things. It says to put away doubtful habits. It says, throw off everything. Don't miss this. Throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. Now, sin is one thing. Everybody knows. Matter of fact, if you know a sin and you know somebody next to you, if you don't know them, please don't say a sin to them. But if you know one, a person, lean over and tell them a sin. Just tell them one real quick. Just say, here's a sin I know, right? Go ahead. Now, why people are laughing about sin, I have no idea. How many know lying's a sin? How many know cheating's a sin? How many know adultery's a sin? You know that. We all know this. But here's the thing, the sin is one thing, but it says this, we need to get rid of everything that hinders. That's not sin. It's just slowing you down from being great for God. Throw off the sin, but anything that hinders, a doubtful habit, I want to just say it this way, there's sin and there's setbacks. I'm about to start preaching. And what happens is setbacks can mess you up just as much as sin can. And you need to get rid of the setbacks. Whatever it is that trips you up from being effective for the cause of Christ. And you know what it is. And if you know Christ, the Spirit of God's telling you right now. And you need to get rid of it. Matter of fact, I encourage you to do what the Scripture says. You need to cut it out. Cut it out of your life. Get rid of it. And you need to do it immediately. Why? Because I want to be as effective as I can for the cause of Christ. Time's short and I want to make a difference. And you need to get rid of every sin, but you also need to get rid of every setback that keeps you, hindrances that keeps you from being effective. The fourth thing you and I need to do is this. We need to obey the Spirit of God and His prompting immediately. And the only way you can do that is to make sure you know the Spirit of God. Nehemiah heard the word of God. He was a Jewish slave working in an unbelievable task. He was in the king's presence. He was at the palace. He had everything he wanted. He heard the Spirit of God lead. He did what he said. You need to do the same thing. What's God saying to you? Do it. Is he saying text that person? Do it immediately. Is he saying call them? Do it immediately. Is he saying pray over them? Do it immediately. Obey the Spirit's prompting. Abraham was called in Hebrews 11:8, not knowing where he was going. But he said, do it, do it. Obey immediately. Get excited about it. Verse 14 of 1 Corinthians 2 says, but when people who aren't spiritual can't receive these truths from God's Spirit, it all sounds like foolishness to them. And the reason maybe you haven't heard the Spirit of God is because you haven't received the fire of God. But the spiritual can, the Scripture goes on there in verse 14 of 1 Corinthians 2, says this, those that do know Christ that are saved can understand what the Spirit says. The last thing I encourage you, if you want to build, continue to build, stay on fire, take it to the next level, change your marriage, change your home, change your health, change your kids, change your future, change your business, reconstruct, rebuild, is you need to go public with your witness for Jesus Christ. Nehemiah did. I mean, he stood on the wall and didn't come down when everybody else tried to take him down. You need to go public with your witness for Jesus. Matter of fact, the Bible says it this way in Romans chapter 1 and verse number 16. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I encourage you not to be ashamed. Get bold. Tell somebody. Share with somebody. If Jesus has changed you, tell someone. Share the gospel with them. Encourage them. Tell them why things are different. Tell them why your business is different. Jesus' desire is 2 Peter 3:9, that none should perish, but all should come to repentance. And now we got to do our part. Go public. You want to stay fired up? Get serious about the mission. Tell some. It's contagious. It's contagious. Last service, I had a friend that came to me. He's like, hey, I invited my friend. He came today. Just jacked up and excited. I said, whoa, calm down. Calm down, crazy charismatic Christian. Calm down. If you don't have a mission, if you're not building nothing, you're not excited about it. You want to get excited, but you can't wait to tell him. If he's changed you, you can't wait. If you had a cure to cancer, you'd give it to everyone. You got the cure to eternal cancer through Jesus Christ. Why aren't you telling somebody? Most people, it's because you're embarrassed. That's what the word of shame means. You just won't even share. Oh, I don't want to offend anybody. You know, I don't offend my... Very few people will be offended. Most people aren't bold enough to be offended. Unless they get on Facebook later and talk about it. I just encourage you to go bold. Man, it's so exciting. Matter of fact, these five things, these five areas for spiritual revival, I read when I was called to the ministry. It's actually the five things that Evan Roberts preached when he started, through the power of the Holy Spirit, the Welsh revivals at 1903 and 1904. 28-year-old coal miner. Matter of fact, coal miners motivated their mules with unique language to get the coal out of the mines. They would use words that I can't say on stage. They'd say, move it, blankety blank, move, you know, they'd whip their mules. Well, he had led so many of his coal miner friends to Christ, coal production reduced by over 50%. And then the businesses came down. It's like, what's going on here? It's like, well, I can't yell at my mule and say this word anymore because Jesus has changed me. He's like, well, we need to find a new way to do this. Well, the pastor heard about this young guy who's been coming to church every Wednesday night, covered in coal and soot and dirt. And he'd come up every Wednesday night. He's like, man, I'm excited about what God's doing in your life, Evan. So exciting. He's like, yeah, it is. I'd love to share it with the church what God told me. And he was like, oh, yeah, God bless you. And he kept coming to him week after week. And then finally he said, okay, Evan, I'll let you share on Wednesday night when everybody dismisses. It's a true story. Read it. Everybody dismissed. And as people were walking out the door, he said, one of our young 28-year-olds wanted to share something that God put on his heart. If anybody wants to say, seven people stayed. He shared those five things from his quiet time. 6 months later, over 600,000 people prayed to receive Jesus Christ. Now, I'm just saying, what if you went public? What if we got serious about this? No more playing games. That so affected my life, I named my second child after that guy, Evan. What if you went public? Why don't you? Today's your day. And the reason many don't is because you got to settle point number one. And I just encourage you, with your heads bowed and your eyes closed, to settle point number one. And there are many in the sound of my voice that aren't sure if you were to die right now that you'd spend eternity with Jesus. You don't understand the Spirit of God. You don't hear the Spirit of God. You're done playing games. You're done guessing. You're done wondering. I just want to encourage you right now to do what the Bible says and confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and believe in your heart that he's risen from the dead. Jesus says, I'll rescue you. Because the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And Jesus says, if we confess our sins, he's faithful. He's just to forgive. He'll do so. The wages of sin separates us. And all you have to do is simply right there, right now, just say, Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner. I need you to save me, rescue me. I'm done playing games. I'm done playing church. I'm done wondering if. I'm done wondering about maybes. I'm done. I repent of my sin. I am turning from my way. I'm surrendering to your way. I'm done with my direction. I'm giving you the steering wheel of my life. I'm headed in your direction. In Jesus' name.